In the very heart of a city that has seen a population growth of nearly a million people in the past 100 years, there remains one lasting trace of a time long past. Though the restored Victorian Rosson House is an elegant reminder of those times today, she did not always stand so proudly. The year was 1894, and the young city of Phoenix was experiencing its first building boom ever. Horses and carriages tread on unpaved roads, and Washington, not central, was the main drag. Dr. Roland Lee Rosson and his family were prominent members in the community. Dr. Rosson had established a medical practice and was active in politics. His wife, Flora, came from an affluent family.
Flora Rosson's half-sister owned this land first. She bought it shortly after the city was first surveyed. It was at the edge of the town site of Phoenix.
Flora purchased the land in 1882 for $1,000.
At the time, newspaper articles were describing this as one of the finer areas in town.
The house was completed in 1895. The Rossons only lived there a short time before renting the house to an influential New York newspaper man named Whitelaw Reid.
Whitelaw Reid's letters have been saved, and they tell us more information about the house than really we've gotten from any other early sources.
In 1897, the Rossons sold the house to Phoenix merchant and legislator Aaron Goldberg. The Goldbergs owned the house for about 5 years before selling it to Stephen W. Higley. Higley had at one point been publisher and part owner of the early Arizona Republican. He also had some land south of Phoenix, and eventually the town of Higley was named after him. S.W. Higley then sold the house to the Gamble family, who lived in the house for nearly 35 years.
We moved here in 1914. I was 5 years old, and I lived here until 1948.
Georgia Valier is now 85 years old. She was the youngest of the three Gamble daughters. The family kept the downstairs rooms to themselves and rented the upstairs rooms as apartments.
Well, my sisters and I, we had a lot of fun here, and we had a lot of friends. Governor Hunt, he would stop here. As he said, this was the halfway place between the Capitol and his home out there on McDowell. And he would stop and sit out there on the porch and rocking back and forth, you know, and fanning himself. And Mama would give him lemonade and lemon cookies.
It is no surprise that the house appealed to such prominent early Phoenix residents, with its steeply angled roofs, long chimneys, and delicately ornamented gables. The corners of these gables made excellent nesting areas for pigeons, and one time the sisters decided they had to have a pigeon of their own.
We got Tootsie to crawl out this little window upstairs in the attic up there. She crawled out and walked on that 2x4 and got a little baby squab. Well, when my mother discovered what we did, oh, she said she could have fell.
Other changes included enclosing the upstairs patio and painting the house white. After the Valiers sold the house, it exchanged hands several times, and for about 25 years it served as a rooming house.
Oh, I used to feel so bad when I'd pass here and notice how the old house was just deteriorating. It just looked terrible. It just made me so sad that I hated to pass by here.
19 people lived in the house when the city of Phoenix bought it in 1974. A restoration committee headed by former Mayor John Driggs was appointed in 1975, and the project was underway. It was funded solely through community support.
We asked a lot of companies to contribute cash. A lot of them stepped right up and contributed services. Suppliers contributed materials. And it was a true community effort. We had whole teams of architects out here volunteering their time on Saturdays, measuring the entire house in great detail to do a set of drawings that the house literally could have been built from scratch.
The first thing that had to be done was to tear down all of the additional rooms that had been built onto the house. Based almost completely on early photographs, reconstruction of the house began. The iron cresting along the ridge of the roof was recast in New Orleans. The curved corbels were duplicated and replaced, and 2,000 shingles were added to the roof.
Now that is the original tower, and those shingles, those oak leaf shingles, are the original ones that were installed in 1895. Now, the weather vane there is exactly the same, and it's been standing there for 100 years.
As crews were progressing on the exterior of the house, workers on the inside were also making exciting discoveries.
During the restoration, the workmen felt like they were detectives trying to determine what had been here before. It started with the floors. They were covered in later years with tar paper and linoleum. When they took up each layer, they found parquet borders in all of the various rooms downstairs, and they'd been protected over the years as the house was deteriorating. The wallpaper required a lot of work during the restoration. The workmen had to go through each layer, take off piece by piece, and all of the rooms had different papers too. Then when they got to the bottom layer of paper, they took as large a sample as they could off the wall, sent it back east to be authenticated. Once it was authenticated, then it was reproduced.
Ironically, the house that took the Rossons 6 months to build took almost 6 years to restore. And though the house originally cost only $7,500 to build, restoration costs totaled $750,000. Today, the Rosson House is one of the 8 historical homes that grace Heritage Square downtown.
When you walk in the front door of the Rosson House, it's like a step back in time. It's our roots. And as you go through the house, you'll see so much. And each time you come back, you'll see more. There's so much to our past. History is so important.